Hi everyone, I am Mr. Aldali Shanabasappa. Welcome you all for the sessions on utilization of electrical power subject. Yes, I am going to start sessions on utilization of electrical power, which is a vital subject for an engineer students. Especially, electrical engineer must know about the utilization of electrical power. As a common human being, we all know that electrical power plays an important role in our day-to-day life. We can't even imagine the single day without electrical power. We are totally dependent on the electrical power, and in this subject, we will discuss about what are the major applications of electrical power in industry as well as in the domestic field. Right. So, without taking much time on the introduction, let's move on for the first application of electrical power. So that is electrical heating. So here we come with that. Electrical heating is in a first chapter or a first module for an engineering student. So in next module, we'll discuss about the domestic lighting, and then we go for an electrical tractions, where we'll discuss about the electrical vehicles, electrical trains, right? So let's begin with the electrical heating and welding. So first chapter consists of both heating and welding, and that we'll discuss about electrical heating. So let's look into the introduction of the heating of electrical by electrical energy. So we all know that heating is nothing but what we consider a device, its temperature is more, right? So we can obtain this heat normally by burning the elements like wood. You can look into this picture now. You can obtain the heat by burning wood, by burning the coal, or by burning gas, by burning oil, so etc. We can have so many burning materials which can be burnt, and by which we can convert that into a heat energy. We can burn the coal and we can get a heat out of it. We can burn the wood, we'll get heat out of it. Likewise, we can burn the gas, we can burn the oil, and we get heat out of it. But the question is here, whether is this is a proper way or is it an efficient way to get the sufficient heat out of it? So you can look into the point mentioned over there. The major concept here is, once we burn the fossil fuels or once we burn the wood or a coal, we get a smoke and a ash out of it, which is going to create a lot of pollution in the surrounding atmosphere. So that is the drawback with the traditional system of heating. So because of this drawback, we got a new concept of heating, that is electric heating. So heat is generated using electrical energy. So here we can see some of the samples where we generate the heat using electrical energy. So this is a room heater, a oven like, and you can look into this picture where you have a room heater. The heat is, see, look at the surface here on the rooftop. On the top we have the provision for the heating of an electrical parameters. Using electrical parameters, we heat it and the heat will be surrounded in the room. So this is just an picture shows that these are some of the type of applications where electrical heating is used. And now we shall move on in detail about the electrical heating. So as we saw in the previous slide, we have different sources of producing the heat. But even though we go for an electrical energy, so there must be some advantages of electrical energy. And you should just think about one point here. In order to get the electrical energy for heating, we need to generate electrical energy. So in order to generate electrical energy, again we go for burning of coal, that is in terms of a thermal power plant, right? It means we are not using that source directly to heat. We are using the source to generate the electrical energy, and from that electrical energy we generate the heat. So this process creates some loss. We can look into the next slide. Yes, here it is. Any form of energy, instead of being directly used, it first converted into electrical energy and then used to do any other form of work. So as I told you, look into this. We have a
solar energy here, we have thermal energy, hydro energy. So these are some of the sources by which we can generate the electrical energy. So thermal energy can also be used to develop the heat. So instead of directly using this thermal energy to develop the heat, we are using this thermal energy to develop electrical energy, and from that electrical energy we use it to develop the heat. So we are not, instead of being directly using it as a source for a heat, we are using electrical energy. So it shows that solar energy, thermal energy, these are all these traditional ways are not giving you the proper output in terms of a heat. So electrical energy will give the better output as a heat. So that's the reason thermal energy, solar energy, all these are used to convert that into electrical energy, and from electrical energy it will be converted into a heat energy. So that conversion has been shown here. First we get the thermal energy and converted it into electrical energy, that is the conversion, and we get reconversion here. Electrical energy will be giving you the heat. It will give you the heat and light, but according to this, now we will just discuss about heat. Light we will discuss in the next module, okay? So now let us discuss about the heating. So we are converting it to electrical energy, and again we are reconverting it into heat. This process definitely will have some losses. So that's what I mentioned here. While doing this, there is a loss of energy. Even though there is a loss of energy in this process, we are going for electrical energy, because when we compare this loss with the advantages of an electrical energy, this loss will be very negligible. So we can ignore this loss, right? So here look into this point now. However, the reconversion, that is electrical energy into other form of energy, it may be heat. Now in the according to this concept, we are converting electrical energy into heat energy. So this reconversion process is having very high efficiency. Look at this point, it is going to have very high efficiency, and the several advantages, we have so many advantages of electrical energy to do the conversion, to do work, that will overweigh the small disadvantage of loss of energy during conversion. So whatever the loss we are getting during the conversion, that can be ignored or that can be neglected, because it's going to have very high efficiency during reconversion. Means reconversion means electrical energy into heat energy. That conversion, during that conversion will have very high efficiency, and also electrical energy will have a lot of advantages which we are going to see in just few seconds. So these advantages, because of these advantages, we can ignore the disadvantage of a loss of energy during conversion. So what is the conversion? Converting the thermal energy into electrical energy, or solar energy into electrical energy. So this is what one single drawback we have. We need to convert it, but once we convert it, after that we will have a better efficient output. That's the reason we go for electrical point. So, and also we need to understand what are those advantages. Here I just mentioned there are several advantages. So let's have a look over that advantages in the further slides. Before going into the advantages of this electrical heating, we shall understand where do you actually use this electrical heating. Here we come. Already I told you in the beginning of this session that electrical engineering, electrical power is used in domestic as well as in industrial concepts. So here I have mentioned, I have just listed some points, some important points where we can have an application of electrical energy. Look at this, it's a domestic portion, and here we have a industrial portion. So in this domestic points, we have room heating, we have water heating, cooking. Yes, we have an electrical stove to cook, we have electric toaster, we have electric iron, etc. So on. We can include so many points here. We can include so many points in this list. I just given few points here. So that's the point we have mentioned here, etc. So that you can add up few more points. Not a problem. Look into the industrial application here. We have melting of metals. So if you want to melt any raw materials, we use an electrical concept energy over there. Heat treatments like annealing, tempering, soldering, enameling of copper wire, etc. So don't forget this. We have some more examples over there. I just taken few points. So these are the applications in industry generally where we use an electrical energy. So now let's understand. You all knowing about room heating, water heating, cooking. These domestical applications will be known for each and everyone. Now let's have some idea about what is this industrial application. We have annealing, tempering, soldering, enameling of copper wires. So let's see what all these means. Okay, so let's look into the concept called annealing. Here annealing in this sense, heating and allowed to cool slowly. We will consider if it is of a metal or a glass, metal or glass it is. So we will just heat it to a high temperature and then slowly we will cool it down. That glass or a metal will be heated to a high temperature and slowly we will just make it to cool. Then what happens, it will just avoid or remove the internal stress and it will increase the toughness of that particular metal or a glass. So annealing is generally used, it's a process of heating a metal and cooling it slowly. It's a simple statement, and this is used to remove the stress, internal stress of that particular metal and increases the toughness of it. So this is process for heating. We use electrical energy, that's why we call it as an application of electrical energy in a industry. Then we have one more point, that is tempering. So tempering is similar to the annealing one, but a small change. It improves the hardness, it improves the brittleness. In other words, we can call it as a brittleness and elasticity of steel by reheating and then cooling it. Here also we are doing it heating and cooling, but not slowly. See, that is the one difference we have here. We heat the metal and we cool it. By doing this, we can improve the brittleness and elasticity of that metal. Hardness will be improved. So that is the process where again we use electrical energy to heat. That's the application. Then we have soldering. Soldering is a simple process in which two or more metal items are joined together. It may be a similar items are joined together. How we are going to join it? By melting. So what system we use for melting? Again, electrical supply. Electrical power is used to melt, right? So that's why it comes under the electrical utilization system. So melting, and then we flow some filling materials to join it. So that is called soldering. They just used to join the same metals. But melting is important. How do we melt? By using an electrical power, right? Then we had one more application there, that is enameling of copper wire. So enameling of copper wire is nothing but just providing, you might have observed the copper wires or wires which may be a copper or aluminium. Generally in domestic purpose we use a copper wire. So on that copper wire there will be an insulation, right? And it will be transparent. You can see the copper wire is in that insulation. A thin insulation will be there. That thin layer of insulation makes it useful for building the windings, building the motors, transformers and all those things. So how to get that thin layer? That process is called enameling of copper wire. On that copper wire you will have the insulating material, and that insulating material will be melted on the copper wire. That will provide a thin layer. So how do we melt that? Again using the electrical power. So these are some of the applications which we use in industry. We have electrical furnaces, we have electrical so many components in industry. I just taken few points out of it, right? So I hope these applications are very clear for you guys. Now let's have a look over the advantages of electrical heating. This is an important topic because we have so many advantages in electrical heating, because of which this has been used as an application in an industry, and we use this concept in our syllabus. This has been included into a syllabus, right? So let's see what are these advantages of electrical heating over the other source of a heating. The very most first point is cleanliness. Cleanliness. As we all know that electrical energy is the cleanest form of energy, which is not going to produce any ash, it will not produce any dust during the heating, it is not going to make any noise during the heating. And also the cleaning costs are minimum as the material being heated is not contaminated. Means we are not going to provide any dust over there. So the heating system of electrical power will be very clean. See, we are discussing the advantages of electrical heating, not the advantages of electrical power. Okay, so where we use an electrical power to heat the device, there we won't get any ash, we won't get any dust, so it will be very clean. That's the point. So that's the reason it has been mentioned as cleanliness is one advantage. So next you can see the higher efficiency. The efficiency of utilizing the electrical power is much higher compared to other systems of heating, because this electrical power can be brought directly to the point where heat is required. Means we can directly give the supply to the point where actually we require the heat. Okay, so this is going to reduce the losses. In other words, we can say this is going to increase the efficiency. Almost the efficiency of electrical heating will be more than 75%. Here we can note down few points. Here the electrical heating efficiency will be more than 75%, whereas it is 30% for solid fuels. If you burn the solid fuels like wood, coal, then it will be of a 30%. If you are burning the oil, then the heat developed out of it will be of a 50%. If you are burning the gas, then heat available out of it will be 60%, right? So compared to all these traditional sources, heating of electrical heating will give you more than 75%. That's the reason why we can mention it as a higher efficiency compared to the other systems. Now let's move for the next advantage, that is ease of control. So this is most important advantage of electrical heating, which we won't get generally in the other traditional methods. So ease of control is nothing but it will be very simple, reliable and accurate control of temperature can be obtained. We can obtain accuracy in the temperature what we require by using some switching systems. Okay, so the desired temperature with an accuracy of almost plus or minus 5% can be obtained in electrical heating. If you want to say, for example, say I want to adjust temperature for 1000 degrees Celsius, we will have an automatic switching system which will control the input of electrical supply, which can give you 1000 degree temperature accurately. But when you want to develop the 1000 degree temperature by using a burning a coal, then the quantity of coal what we need to pour over there may not give you accurate output, because that quantity is poured by a human being. Even though we have automatic system over there, here and there we get the less accuracy because of the output of that coal may not give you, means because the size of the coal will not be same, so we may not get the accurate output. So in this case, when we give an electrical supply, we can possible it is highly possible to find a better accurate output. The temperature can be easily controlled. So that's why we can say it is a ease of control, right? So now let's see the next point of advantage is heating of insulating materials. Okay, so insulating materials means like wood. If you want to heat the wood, if you want to heat the plastic, so these are some of the insulating materials, then we have to go for an electrical heating only, because wood is a source of providing a heat. Now I want that heat, means I want to give a heat for wood, so then we don't have any other alternate method. We can go for charcoal, but that will not give you the uniform heating over there. So if you want to have a uniform heating for an dielectric systems, then we go for an electrical heating only, right? So in electrical heating, we have dielectric heating that comes into picture here. So for heating of insulating materials, again we use electrical energy. The next option of advantage will be it's a pollution free. Pollution free is nothing but during electrical heating, we won't get any flue gases out of the cylinder. We won't get any, we won't produce any gas or smoke. So the pollution will not be there. Atmosphere will not get polluted. That's what the simple point we can highlight in the application of electrical heating. And the next point is special heating requirements. Yeah, in some cases we need to have an heating at particular portion of the material. So only front portion of that material should be heated, but not the side portion. Then this electrical heating will give you the accurate output over there. You can adjust the system which can heat only one portion of the material, not the other one, right? So that kind of heating can be done here. That is a special requirement. And also we can have uniform heating of a material, or we can also have a particular portion heating of a material, which is not much easily possible with the other traditional methods, right? And also in this electrical heating we also not get a oxidation. We won't get any oxidation in the sense that will not be get chemically reacted. Okay, electrical heating, and if I'm heating some steel, that heating will not give any chemical reactions over there on steel. That is one more important advantage. Next we shall see about the safety. We can provide automatic protection against overcurrents. We can also provide automatic protection against overheating, right? So these are major devices we have. These are major advantages we have in electrical heating. We have some power electronic concepts, we have some switching systems which can be used, we have some relays, we have some circuit breakers, we have some protecting devices which can be used to identify the overcurrent and overheating in a system. For example, say I want to develop a 3000 degrees Celsius in a furnace, and due to some excess of input supply or due to some problem, if it has been increased, if the temperature is more, if it is for 3500 degrees Celsius, automatically there will be a protection system which will sense it. There will be a temperature sensor which will sense it, and the system will be under control. The system will be shut down or the alarm will be given. Some safety concept will be, precautions will be provided easily if it is electrical heating, right? So that is the major advantage of having an electrical heating in a industries. Now let's move for the other advantage, that is in a high temperature. Definitely, as I told you, when we have a control over the temperature, then we can develop whatever the temperature we want just by increasing the input supply, right? So we can develop the whatever the temperature we want, and we have only one limit over there, that is the material must be able to withstand the temperature, isn't it? I can develop 10,000 degrees Celsius, I can develop 1 lakh degrees Celsius, yes, we can develop. But if material is not able to withstand, then it's no use of developing that much of temperature. So the limit what we have here is that material should withstand the temperature. So in other words, I can say that we can develop the temperature as much as the material requires. We don't have much limit over there, right? So that is one advantage, and it can be done easily. The temperature can be increased easily. Next point is low maintenance cost. As we know that normally we don't require much supervision here, because all automatic system will be there. So we don't need much supervisor, some much labors to take care of that. So the maintenance cost is going to be low. Even we don't get dust, we don't get ash. So the electrical heating maintenance will be very low compared to other systems. And because of all these conditions, like low maintenance cost, it is higher efficiency is very high, all right, ease of control. So we don't have much losses in this kind of a system. So we can easily say that economically it will be very good. Electrical energy, generally what we generate that electrical energy, it will be generated in a large scale. So it's going to become cheaper when we purchase it. So when we are developing it in a large scale, when we are producing it in a large scale, we get it at a low cost, right? So the initial cost of electrical furnaces is cheaper, and the maintenance cost is also minimum because they occupy less space, storage space is not required, and no chimney is required. These are the most important things you need to understand. I am just giving an example of an electrical furnace. Electrical furnace, instead of electrical furnace, if you have a wood furnace, now that comparison I am doing here, electrical furnace will become cheaper because it's no need to have a chimney. The storage space is also not required. Means when you go for a wood furnace, we want to store the wood, so there space is required. But now when you go for electrical furnace, we don't need a storage for that, so storage space is not required. and they occupy less space, right? So because of all these things, we can say the cost required will be less. So economically, it is going to be good. So these are the most important advantages of electrical heating. I hope these advantages, you got the points. Till now, whatever we discussed, I think it is clear for you. If it is clear, you just share among others also. Now let's move on for the next concept in this electrical heating. Now after looking into the advantages of electric heating, now before going to start the types of electric heating, we need to understand what are the major modes of heat transfer. So even in the basic electrical engineering or even in the PUC or in our school days, you might have studied about the modes of heat transfer in general. So there are three modes of heat transfer. Here we have mentioned it. So there are three modes of heat transfer from a body, okay, from a body at high temperature to a body at low temperature. Heat will be transferred from high temperature body to low temperature. And let us see what are those three modes of heat transfer. The first mode is a conduction mode. The second one is convection mode. And I hope you got the third one now. You can easily guess it out because from school days we used to go through across this. So that is the radiation. Yes, you are correct. So conduction, convection and radiation are the three modes by which heat will be transferred from a heat body to a low temperature body. So now we will understand these three concepts: conduction, convection and radiation, so that when we go for a methods of electric heating, there you can just conclude that whether this method is a conduction method or a convection method or a radiation method. So we will relate it when we go for a types of electric heating. So before going into that, we need to know what are these three. So I'll just recall these three in brief because these are the things which you have studied in even in the school days. So here the conduction, first comes the conduction. So look into the picture here. There is a direct contact, means you look into the definition also we have mentioned here. Conductive heat transfer happens when two solids touch each other or there is a physical contact. So whenever there is a physical contact between the hot body and the cold body, then the heat from the hot body will be transferred to the cold body. That is the concept called conduction. So in other words, we also define it in this way. So the transfer of heat by means of molecular excitement. See, this is the technical words I'm using here. Molecular excitement within a material without motion of the matter, or in a simple words we can say the heat will be transferred from molecule to molecule but without actual movement of molecules. So that is important thing. So as we all know that whenever we take any solid material, there will be molecules in that solid metal, right? So look at this gas here. There is a gas fire here and heat. This is a hot body and this is conduction. This is a cold body. This is a handle, right? So if this is also a metal body, then the molecules what we have here, that will be heated up and that heat is transferred from molecule to molecule and it will be reaching this cold body. But molecules will not move without actual movement of molecules. Molecules will be staying over there without movement of molecules. Just heat is transferred, heat is moving. So it is called conduction method. Directly the heat is moving to hot body to cold body. So conduction heat transfer in gases and liquid is due to the collision. See, this concept what I explained here, this is in a solid material. Okay, when we have a solid material, this is a solid material and this is a solid material. But when we use it in a gas and a liquid, there we get this conduction due to the collision and a diffusion of molecules during the random movement, during the random movement or a random motion. So generally conduction happens in the solid materials, right? We get the conduction in a liquid and a gas, but of less quantity. There we get some other methods, that is convection and a radiation. So we can have this relation here. This equation will give you the relation of heat, means the rate of heat transferred across a solid plate. So heat transferred across a solid plate is given as H stands for heat is equal to some equation I have written here. So let's see, it's Ka by T into T1 minus T2. So here let's see what actually the parameters, what is H, what is K, what is A, let's look into that. So here H is nothing but heat transferred, and it's most important for an engineering student to understand the units. Anybody can say easily that H stands for heat because we are discussing about heat. But what is the unit? It's a watts per meter square, right? How much of power is dissipated per unit area? Area unit is meter square and power unit is watts. So power dissipation per unit area, that is nothing but heat transfer. So unit will be watts per meter square. And K is a constant, it is a coefficient of thermal conductivity, and this is given in terms of watts per meter Kelvin. So here I mentioned it, watts per mk, watts per meter Kelvin. It depends upon the type of material what we use, right? So T1, T2, these are the two different temperatures in Kelvins. It is given in terms of Kelvins, temperatures of the two phases. If you take one solid bar, it will have two phases. So what is the temperature at one phase and the other phase? So that difference will be there. So that is T1 and T2. We need to consider the difference of it. And thickness of the plate. So the rate of heat transfer depends upon all these parameters. What is the thickness of that plate? What are the phases? The temperature difference between the phases and coefficient of that thermal conductivity and heat transfer. What is the power dissipation per meter square? So all these parameters are responsible to decide the heat dissipated. This happens, this is for solid material, right? Because conduction is generally considered in a solid material. So we are given an example for an equation for a heat dissipation in a solid plate, right? So next, let's go for the second way of heat transfer, that is convection. So convection is the transfer of heat from one place to another by movement of fluids or actual movement of molecules. So that is the major difference between the conduction and convection. So in conduction, heat was transferred but molecules were not moving, without movement of molecule. But in convection, heat is transferred by the actual movement of the molecules. Molecules are also moving here, alright. So this convection is dominantly used or dominant in liquid and gases. Conduction is dominating in solid materials. When we go for liquid and gaseous, convection comes into picture. So have that point in your mind. When you are transferring the heat in a solid materials, most of the heat will be transferred through the conduction. So when we are heating when we are heating a liquid and a gas, then heat is transferred maximum through convection method, right? So we can't say that there is no conduction here, there is no convection in the previous case. It will be there, but this plays an important role or a dominant role in the liquid and gas, right? So now let's see the what is the rate of heat transferred in this using convection method, and this is the formula for that. H is equal to A T1 minus T2 B to the power of B watts per meter square, where A and B are constants whose values are depend on the type of heating surface, right? Type of the surface, type of the material, that's what we can say. Means if it is, you have taken an example here for vertical surface, and if you are going for a horizontal surface. If it is for vertical surface, A will be 3.875 and B will be 1.25. So this is just an example or a sample we are given. If we are heating vertical or we are heating a horizontal surface, based on that A and B values are going to change, and also it depends upon the what type of material we are heating over there. So this is about the convection. Here heat transferred through the actual movement of the heated molecules, whereas in conduction, heat transferred by the heat is transferred without moving the molecules. Now let's move for the third and the last mode of a heat transfer, that is radiation. So in this mode, we can say that heat is transferred from one body to other body without heating the actual medium, right? Actually heating the medium in between, right? So without heating the, here you come, without actually heating the medium in between, right? So here you may feel that what actually this means without eating actually heating medium. So what is this? Let's give an example to understand this concept here. Look at this. We have sun here and we have earth. We will get sunlights which is going to fall on earth. And on this earth, we human being and even earth feels the temperature, right? Earth will get heated up if we have more sunlight, right? So earth is getting the heat, means the heat is transferred from sun to earth. But in between, what this medium we have in between, the atmospheric air, right? That will not much heated. So without eating the medium in between, between sun and earth we have a medium, but this is not heated. The heat is directly transferred to the earth. This process is called radiation. Means we are transferring the heat without actually eating the medium in between. So I hope now you got the meaning of this statement, without actually eating the medium in between. You can take another example here. We have fire. Most of you might have attended the fire camp, you might have enjoyed in your life. So this is the fire and we are just taking the heat of it, right? We are just, if it is a cold, during the cold region or during the winter and rainy seasons, we used to do this, right? We'll have a fire and we'll just get heat of body, right? So we are not going to touch this fire directly. If you do it, it will be a conduction, but generally we won't do that, right? It will just heat and it will just burn your body. So we'll just be far away from that. Through the radiation, we are going to get that heat. But in between what we have here, this medium is not going to heat up that to that much of temperature what our body is going to heat, right? So without heating the medium in between, we are getting the heat. That process is called radiation system, isn't it? So I hope I have given the even examples of the radiation, where do we use it, right? So let's see the equation for heat transferred through radiation system. So through radiation, what is the heat transferred? So this is the formula: 5.72 into 10 to the power of 4 into Ke, and we have T1 by 1000 to the power of 4, and this is the equation you can look into here, right? So this equation we are not going to derive it, because we just need to have an idea out of it. So where K and E, let's see, because we know what is H, it is a heat transfer. T1 is nothing but the temperature of one phase, T2 is nothing but temperature of the other phase of the solid material. Now let's see the K. It's a constant and it is known as radiant efficiency. If we have only single element in between the sun and earth, then we get it as an efficiency as 1. If we have more several elements placed side by side, means between the fire and between you, if we have some elements, then definitely the heat received by you will be less. So the efficiency, that radiant efficiency, is going to be reduced if you have several elements placed in between. If you have single element, then we will have the high efficiency, right? You can understand this picture here. You can look into this picture. If you don't have any element in between, the efficiency is high. The single element is air, so the efficiency is high, 1, radiant efficiency. If I place some elements here, if I place some solid elements like this, then the heat received by you will be reduced. That radiant efficiency will be reduced to 0.5 to 0.8%, 50% to 80%. That's the concept of K. Now let's see what is E. E is nothing but emissivity. Emissivity depends upon the type of body. If the body is black, then it emits the heat observation. Whatever the heat observed will be 100%. If the body is of different resisting elements, then it will be less than that. To understand this, I will tell you solar heaters. For solar heaters, we will have a plant black painting so that the solar sun rays can be absorbed easily. So that is an emissivity, observing the radiations. So black body will absorb it completely. That's why in summer people will say that don't wear the black pants or black shirts, because it absorbs the heat directly and efficiency will be very high, so that it will absorb and that will create a heat to your body. So I hope these are the concepts were very clear for you. So in next session we will discuss about the methods of electrical heating, right? Thank you for being in the session. So let's wind up this session for today. Thank you all.